Hi everyone. Welcome to our webinar on the importance of mental health at the workplaces today. I am Shreya Prakash and I have with me Tanya Chaudhary, who is the head of growth and partnerships at InnerR, and Pratishtha Trivedi Mirza, who is a senior psychologist working with InnerR. An introduction about InnerR, a very short one, and I'll leave it to Tanya and Pratishtha to speak a little bit more about it. So InnerR is a startup in the mental health space, and they provide holistic solutions both for individuals and corporates. Not to be outdone, a little bit of an introduction about FlexiBees, of which I'm one of the co-founders. We provide part-time, project-based and remote working talent to businesses via qualified women professionals returning to work. So let's start with the webinar. This is a topic that I'm very interested in. I think it's extremely relevant at this point in time, especially, but even beyond, the importance of mental health cannot be overemphasized in today's times. So I hand it over to Tanya and Pratishtha to perhaps talk a little bit more about what InnerR does.
Sure. Thanks, Shreya. I'll maybe talk a little bit about our work overall and a little bit about our work with organizations specifically. Like Shreya mentioned, we work with organizations of different sizes, DNAs, etc. And for us too, it's been a fairly steep learning journey in terms of what varying needs might be and yet how common it really is at the core of it all. We are about 5.5 years old as of today, and we provide end-to-end services for mental health concerns, both for individuals and organizations. Specifically, when we work with organizations, in addition to supporting employees, we also try to map concerns or patterns that may emerge across the organization and work with them to see how we can solve for it in a larger scale manner. So in terms of how we provide this support, we have self-assessments, there are webinars that we run, there is of course therapy, and Pratishtha will be speaking more on that in terms of what her experience has been working for the entire duration of this, as well as a self-help app which allows people to explore their wellness journey at their own pace and convenience. And mental health, overall, I think the conversation has been picking up over the last few years, certainly more so in organizational spaces. But quite unfortunately, I think it is this pandemic since last year, which has really accelerated this topic. I can tell you that in terms of the organizational partners that we support, the number of people we're working with kind of went up by almost 10x since the first lockdown, and it again saw a steep rise over the past month or so when the second wave really started peaking. I'll maybe hand it over to Pratishtha now to talk a little bit about how the pandemic has affected mental health overall, and specifically the second wave patterns and things that you see here, and what organizations are doing to support people in this time.
Sure, thank you, Tanya, and thank you, Shreya, for having us here. So I'm a therapist at InnerR, and I've been here for almost 5 years now, so almost since the beginning. And of course, the goal is to make mental health accessible. But what we have seen in the past 1 year is a very sharp increase in, you know, accessing the services and the products that we are providing, like Tanya said, whether it is the, you know, corporate partnerships or therapy. Right. And definitely there has been, you know, almost the number of sessions that we are taking on a daily, weekly or monthly basis has also significantly increased. We saw a sharp rise when, you know, around say April, May last year, which extended till almost September before it sort of neutralized. And again, since say mid-March till now, so it's like very running parallelly to the wave of the pandemic. And whether it is anxiety, whether it is sadness, whether it is, you know, confusion and fear, which are the more common concerns, and what has happened in the second wave. And you know, I'm here referring to very therapy experience. As a therapist, what I've heard people say is, you know, when there was the first wave, of course, it was all unknown. and you pass through that and you feel that you have understood something, or you're going to get through this. It's, you know, staying at home, staying safe, and that's about it. And then things started opening up, so there was that sense of hope and optimism due to genuine improvement which had happened, right? It was not like very misplaced, I don't know what is happening optimism, but it was based on things, it seemed it was improving. And now then you have the second wave. So the uncertainty which people experienced last time in the first wave, where we didn't know anything, became worse in the second wave. It was because even what you know is not dependable. When you think things are improving, there is, you know, and that's the feeling that people have got, that it seems like, oh, now also the numbers will reduce, but you know, there's talk about a third wave, there's a talk about other kinds of pandemics, black fungus, white fungus, whatnot fungus, it's impacting children. So it's become much more intense this time. And of course, we've seen an, in, you know, almost, if not more, but a definite increase in use of services and people recognizing what it is doing to their mental health.
That's kind of like the silver lining to this extremely dark cloud, that people have more awareness today about their mental health. So one question before we dig deeper into COVID and perhaps things that organizations can do. Why is mental health today, so zooming out a little bit, why is mental health today important at all in workplaces, even outside of a COVID context? What has changed in today's environment versus what it was maybe 10 years ago or 20 years ago? Or do you guys not look at it that way?
So there are a few things I notice, and because I'm not a mental health professional, perhaps I don't have as much of a longitudinal perspective. There has been a case for really including mental health as an active element of employee engagement, as opposed to an add-on benefit that exists somewhere in the background. And as I see it, that research, that conversation, that build-up that was there is suddenly kind of accelerated by being forced to acknowledge the intensity of the situation right now. So we've had very senior leaders, managers, kind of really step up and share their own experiences or experiences that they see around them, around emotional health, to really make it key to talk about it in the workplace. I think there's a very big shift that I can see from my perspective there. And I think that's perhaps going to be the most critical enabler in making this journey possible. And hopefully once this conversation is initiated, we are not looking back. I think that's what we are working with. The other piece is also recognizing the need for formal support. So people are proactively reaching out to us and saying that there's a very critical and immediate need, and we need them to go to the right people. So for a long time, there was a thought that, you know, some things would get solved over time, or problems were possibly at a mild, moderate level. And with some degree of conversation, mentorship, you know, some of which was informed, some of which was well-meaning, that's kind of transformed into this need to say that, no, there is need for specialized support, and we will be enablers in that journey. So managers are actually coming up to us, managers, you know, entrepreneurs, saying that we want to support people, but we are not equipped. And a big part of Pratishtha and her team's work actually now tends to be around that entire piece around sensitization and training. Like, people have come up to us and said, you know, there's someone in my team who's lost someone, and I want to say the right thing, but I'm just not sure what that might be. So something as simple as that, and kind of translating that into a larger manner of being, really a way of functioning in the organization, as opposed to something that's kind of being put on as an external layer. I think that's what this current situation has brought upon us. And I think the benefits to being centered, or even to being emotionally honest, are fairly intuitive, even at a non-professional level for me. It's easier to kind of manage expectations. It's easier to bring my whole self to work, you know, like, I think for us, we spend most of a disproportionate time, really, of the day at our workplaces or kind of continuing conversations with colleagues. And it really just helps to be more authentic. So, you know, the benefits are in terms of how loyal one feels to the organization, how connected one is feeling. And there are also more tangible benefits in terms of improved physical health. And, you know, again, there are related benefits to that at a very business-like level. But I think right now, all of that is really in the background. I think people are recognizing the human crisis for what it is and really trying to support that.
Yeah. Amazing. It's I love the idea of bringing your whole self to work. It's a very, it's a very foundational idea from which lots and lots of, you know, I think the trends around the future of work emerge, and of course a way of living which today is so integrated into how we are at work. And I heard you say at one point that leaders are coming and they are talking about how they themselves feel. So that also is a very interesting, I think, change in the way leadership itself is, right? It's from a strong man sort of persona that perhaps leaders felt in the past they had to project. It's more approachable, more vulnerable. Have you guys seen that change happen in the people you interact with?
I think it's happened almost overnight in terms of the change in tone and conversation, etc. And I think the recognition was always there. But again, like I say, unfortunately, the context has made it an enabler for it to come out without any disclaimers. So I definitely see it in my interactions. There's a lot more honesty and directness in just acknowledging some of these situations. But I think Pratishtha spends a lot more time working with them. So maybe there are some insights there which would be interesting for us.
Yeah, like Shreya, you said, you know, in your question earlier that if, right now the COVID crisis is, you know, just staring us in the face. But along with that, and that has been an enabler for organizations to recognize, but what seems to have happened, you know, in the background of this pandemic or even before that, that the whole concept that work was something which started and ended at a particular time has really changed. The work experience has changed. It has drastically changed, you know, with work from home. But the gradual sort of steps were already there. You know, you didn't like absolutely not, even though, I mean, I am putting a disclaimer out there that it's not the healthiest way to work. But the fact of the matter is that that is what it was. When you're working different time zones, when you're working with, you know, different countries, it was that your work was not compartmentalized, or you did not have the luxury to compartmentalize work like, say, 20 years ago. For 15 years ago. And what that did is, as the boundaries have blurred, the boundaries of what is happening in my life and it not impacting my work has also blurred. So whether my mental health is being compromised because of something that is happening at work, or it is being compromised because it's something else outside, it is going to show up in my work. Because I'm still the same person coming to work. Like Tanya said, your whole self is coming to work, right? I'm not like, I suddenly forget about concerns about my parents' well-being or some relationship issues that I'm having. So it's that recognition that mental health will impact what is happening at work, and mental health even outside work will impact what is happening at work. So it's that recognition which has been sort of pushed to the front by COVID, which is such a big thing which is happening outside, and with definite mental health ramifications that you can't ignore it. You can't ignore it. And, you know, you call a spade and realize whether you're a leader or you're an employee, you're a human being first. You know, like COVID is not differentiating between the big and the small and the rich and the poorer, and neither does mental health. So you're going to be impacted, and it's both very discomforting and humbling at the same time, I think, and leaders are taking it in that sense. So that's what my experience has been.
That's good. Good to know. So COVID, of course, I mean, no conversation today can happen without talking about COVID and certainly not mental health. And a lot of the audience that we talk to or will be watching this will be people who are leading teams. So what is it that people can do in these positions, whether they are leading teams or leading organizations, given that they are facing something unprecedented of this nature for the first time?
If you're a leader, and irrespective of the size of the team that you are leading, what leaders sort of, you know, carry a double burden, if I can call it that. You're of course concerned about your own well-being and the well-being of your loved ones, right? Like everyone else, you are also concerned about the well-being of people who you work with. So that's like another set of people who you care for, and for various reasons at a personal level, and how it then eventually impacts their work. And it's something that they have to carry simultaneously. Right, my own well-being as a leader and my team's well-being as individuals and as a team. So, and like it is unprecedented, nobody knows how to deal with something like this, right? So what's important to deal with this is to be as honest in recognizing that everybody is going through this. Like, you know, let there be no pretense that, okay, I am not impacted, or, you know, our team is not impacted. And, you know, while there is value in focusing on the good, there is also value in calling what you see. So just having open conversations on that, you know, there are a lot of stressors out there. And like Tanya had mentioned earlier, we spend a disproportionate time of our day at work. So, you know, there is opportunity to have conversations. If you're spending 8, 9, 10, sometimes 12 plus hours, you know, sometimes maybe I haven't had as much conversation with a family member as much as I've had with my colleague. So it's both an avenue and an opportunity. So as a manager, as a team lead, utilizing that opportunity and saying, see, we will call it, you know, we'll just do a reality check. This is happening. And because it is impacting everyone, it is also possible that it is impacting our team and specific people. Especially if you start seeing people who are showing some signs, right? Being bothered, not being able to focus, being demotivated, or they have been very, you know, open about it and also said that, you know, this is what is happening in my life. So acknowledging that and saying, okay, what kind of environment or work processes can we create to acknowledge and to accommodate for this very real thing? You know, whether it is at a policy level or at a conversational level, look both, like, you know, the big picture and the everyday immediate thing that you're going to say or do. So it's important to become aware that both are helpful. It's not that I only need to send a check-in message to my team member, but also important that there is some process or policy at place which the team members also know. That, okay, you know, if you're during the, like, a lot of organizations have made work are pretty flexible because people have multiple responsibilities, but you as a leader need to communicate that it's okay. Instead of a 45 minute lunch hour, if you want to take a 1.5 hour lunch hour, because you also have to make food in that time. So just, you know, communicating that is also helpful. I think that to begin with, unless, you know, there are very specific concerns that you're faced with, like Tanya said, losing a family member, losing a team member. Organizations have had that happen also, of course, right? So, but on a more generic level, these are the things that can be started with.
Okay. Another question that I had was, at this time, because a lot of people are working remotely, and this came from what you also said about being able to read some of the signs. Because what may happen is that somebody in your team may not be directly affected, or the people that they live with may not be affected, but say their parents who live in another city, and some of those things are difficult to also detect. But there is mental load. There is definite mental load. There is a lot of anxiety, and sometimes multiplied by the fact that you cannot be there in person. So some of these things may be difficult to detect, say, in a remote environment especially. So are there any things that you guys have seen people do, or that you recommend that leaders should do, especially given that the entire people are working remotely today?
So you're absolutely right. You know, remote work, you know, even in therapy, people ask us, because therapy used to be a very in-person experience usually. And this is a question that I've been asked multiple times as to how do you do online therapy when, I mean, right now I can see you guys, but a lot of times it's chat, a lot of times it's a phone call. Chat has zero cue other than the words that are written. So the bit is that I will not say that, oh, it will be as easy as if someone was there and you can see what is happening on their face. I'm saying there will always be other signs, right? If you see a person's interest reducing, you know, at work, or the fact that they're not being able to keep up with deadlines, or that in general, you know, sometimes you send them a message and they have not responded for a long time and this is not their general behavior. So if you start noticing changes, it is a good enough point to start a conversation. I'm not saying a change says that you assume something is happening, right? But if you've seen continuous and consistent changes have happened, it is a very valid and evidence-based point to start a conversation. You know, every time managers ask, how do you bring up mental health? You know, it's still a little bit of a touchy topic. Mm-hmm. You do not want to assume anything. We say, okay, you always start with some data point. You say, okay, you know, you seem to be not as motivated from past month or so. What is bothering you? Something seems to be on your mind. Would you like to share? And you have, what a sentence like this does is it acknowledges that, okay, I have observed something. It does not assume anything, you know, whether you're concerned about health, whether you're concerned about COVID, whether you're having relationship issues. And it creates a very open space where the other person can also take charge. You're asking them, is there something bothering you? What is bothering you? And they can say, oh, nothing is bothering me. I've just been unwell. That's why I've not been very productive, or things like that. Oh, or I'm not a messaging person, so I don't really respond very well to it. So I think that's a good way to start conversation. Also creating opportunities for informal conversation. You know, there is no water coolers to stand next to and talking, right? And while you could just check in with your co-workers as you pass by their seat, that opportunity is not existing anymore. So being very proactive about creating these informal conversation opportunities within the workplace. You know, whether it's once in 2 weeks, once in a month, every Friday, however you do it. Or sometimes I've told managers that when you're starting even your everyday meeting, start with informal conversation. If it's a 20-minute meeting, if you spend 2-3 minutes being informal or 5 minutes being informal, it's not going to change. You know, the world is not going to end. So start small, and I think that's where you take it from.
Wonderful. I think that those are very helpful. So if I had to, at this point, maybe just quickly summarize, I think important to be authentic. I think that's the most important thing. And like you said, even for leaders, because they are actually bearing the double burden of their team's well-being as well. Secondly, be transparent, or maybe emphasize even the changes that have happened at the policy level, along with doing the everyday human touch actions that that leaders and team leaders are anyway going to do. Thirdly, to create, to check in, to use those, you know, observations that or changes that you see in your team members' normal style of working or behaving, and use those to check in and ask the right questions. And fourthly, to create spaces for informal conversations, whether it is separately or whether it is at the beginning of your get-together as a team or for reviews, which can create... not only does it give people the chance to talk about anything that's bothering them, it's also like a vent for any pent-up stress, you know, because yes, we do spend a lot of time with our colleagues, and we need to also see, our friends in them. We need to, be able to have that level of comfort with them. So that helps a lot. That's great. I think that's very useful. Are there any don'ts at all in this situation that you guys would talk about, things that people shouldn't do at workplaces at this time?
That's an important thing.
Tanya, you want to say some experiences of Don?
No, I think we'll just keep this one from a perspective of mental health. So I'll leave this one to you.
I think, I mean, a lot of them don't like focusing on don'ts, because sometimes you just sort of get stuck in what not to do to take anything, right? But I think two things that I will say as don'ts is not to have a very specific idea as to how people are supposed to respond in any situation, right? I mean, one of the more common conversations we are having, unfortunately, these days is, you know, supporting employees who are grieving, who have lost a loved one. And one of the things that we often talk in those discussions is that people grieve in such varied ways, you know, people, you know, and how people's relationships manifest are also very different. You know, I mean, the reality is not everybody might be as close to their family, and not everybody has the same amount of emotional expressiveness, right? So sometimes you can have employees or individuals who get very bothered in the sense of almost being compromised in functioning by just the general existence of negative incidents, right? I've had many, many sessions where people have become, you know, very visibly distressed, cried in sessions, but not because something has happened to them personally. It's just because they're, you know, very empathetic and observant, and they're you know, spending time thinking about it. And then I've had people who communicated, you know, or talked about very, you know, intense loss experiences in the most stoic manner. So what is a don't is not to assume anything out of both of you. You let the other person guide you. If they say, I'm okay, or if they say, I'm not okay, but I don't want to talk about it, you take that. You don't assume that, oh, this is so weird. Why is this person, you know, so sad? Abhi ye to reality hai. Why are you so bothered about it? Right? So not to assume anything, or not to assume a particular, or like, this is an acceptable response. Right? And second is, in the same way, see, negative emotions are uncomfortable, right? They're distressing. When we feel them, they're distressing. When someone expresses it to us, it's also distressing. So our immediate response is to comfort them and to say, it's okay, it will be fine, which comes from a very well-placed intention. But to not do it too quickly also, to let the person express what they're feeling, and to not say that, oh, you know, I mean, if I give a very out there example, someone has lost a loved one, and you know, saying something very even well-meaning such as, oh, at least they lived a good life, as if them living a good life compensates for the loss that you had. And nobody is saying it with this intention. I'm saying, so in sometimes just not feeling too much of an urge to comfort someone, or feeling the pressure to quickly make them feel better, to just be able to stay, to not give in to that pressure, is what I'm suggesting.
I think since you touched upon this specifically, I'll maybe just draw in a bit from a few things I've seen and even experienced at a personal level. I think just the extent of suffering has been so great this time that out of some sense of combined guilt and gratitude, there is this very strong need to do the right thing. And sometimes we don't know what that right thing might be. So for example, in the instance of people who are grieving, sometimes organizations are very keen that they immediately reach out to a mental health professional, speak it out. And it of course comes from absolutely the right place and intent and everything. But I think in any case, for most people, the decision to speak to someone about their emotions comes after a lot of thinking and, you know, after some amount of processing at a personal level. There are also a lot of logistics involved actually around, you know, when there is a loss, there are a lot of things to be taken care of. A lot of people actually, even beyond mind space, actually don't have the time to reach out to someone and speak to someone there and then. So I think just that balance in terms of letting someone know that this is available and encouraging them, but also kind of making sure that it's their choice and intent. I think that's just something I'd like to add.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah, it'd be good to also know maybe if you guys can talk about what are some organizations doing at this time about helping their teams, or if from your experiences at Inner Art, that would also be useful.
So like I said, I think in my observation, the biggest piece really has been leadership endorsement and conversation. And a lot of it draws from very intense personal experiences, which are not easy for anyone to share. And despite what we might say, I think with leadership, there has been a need to kind of come across as if someone were operating from some level of authority or being in control. And I think that transition into saying that you can be human but still be in control, or that doesn't take away from that, I think that's really been key in terms of also kind of telling people that grieving or acknowledging feelings of any kind really does not also, you know, it's not kind of discordant if you're also functioning on a daily basis. Because, you know, sometimes people say that, you know, I don't know if because I seem to be going to work every day and yet I'm feeling this way. So when you see more people kind of talking about that same conflict, I think a lot of these things don't feel as much of an aberrant. I think just from a conversation perspective, that's how I see it. Many have introduced policies, I think, related to emotional support, but also otherwise in terms of supporting people through this period, kind of having more flexibility in terms of working hours, in terms of other support that they might need. There have been, you know, concerted efforts to really, you know, talk about basically anything that enables people to say that it's all right to feel the way I'm feeling, and also to reach out for support. So I think the conversational piece has been the big part. The enabling piece has also been the big part. But I think there are also policy level changes at various levels that are helping this come true.
Great. I think it's very good to know that leadership is taking these kinds of steps. As with everything in the pandemic, it feels terrible to say that there's been something good that's come out of this, but you know, I guess this is something that was long due, the focus on mental health and conversations around it, and even people just seeing themselves as humans, giving themselves the leeway to feel, to not be okay for some time. I think that's an important one, and definitely in the workplaces as well, which was kind of walled off from any of these conversations in the past. Going forward beyond COVID, since I have you guys here, what do you recommend should leadership continue to do, or, you know, team leaders, or even people, individuals at workplaces should continue to do, you know, in the way of mental health, beyond the very current and immediate situations that COVID has thrust upon us? What should they retain in their behaviors?
So again, for me, I think as a non-domain person, the normalization around conversation is really key. And actually, that's even beyond workplaces, even in our social and personal circles. Like, for example, if COVID or the environment is somehow right now explaining why we are feeling a certain way, I hope we don't look for a reason in the future. but just say that, you know, these are things that happen, these are occurrences, and it's all right because you can tie it over with the right help. I think the important fact is that you know, there is help available, access is greatly increased now, and that it's absolutely fine to make time for oneself and get that support for oneself. So to me, that's the big piece. Pratishtha will have more thoughts, I'm sure.
Absolutely, you know, Tanya, you're very right saying that don't look for a reason, or don't at least look for a reason that you would approve of, as it is impacting your mental health. And also, I mean, what it has, see what mental health is about, by and large, I can get into theory as much as I want, but mental health is about experience, right? Mental health is about emotions, and emotions are what makes us human. So we need to continue to realize or be aware that we are going to be human. So if mental health because of COVID will impact people's you know, productivity or whatever is happening in their life, so will other reasons. And while it is, I mean, I can be practical about it and say mental health of an employee directly impacts what happens to an organization. Yeah. So whether it's through productivity, whether it's through absenteeism, whether it is through job satisfaction and, you know, team, you know, how coherent the team feels, what an employee is going through will always impact the organization. But even if it is not, we are all humans, and to have that empathy beyond how does it directly impact me is a valuable asset in an organization. I want to be part of an organization which is going to support me, even if me being troubled is not directly impacting the organization. So what organizations need to take through is the empathy that I care, we care about our employees as human beings and not as only as resources. I mean, there is truth to that. There's nothing, you know, people work. There is, I'm not arguing with that. Then that in the most basic sense is what would make an organization more, you know, in the long term, more efficient, but in the more short term, more, you know, will call for more commitment, will call for more loyalty from employees also. Mm-hmm. When you see that an organization is going above and beyond for you, you will do it, but not with that intention. I'm not saying organizations need to do it with that intention, but know that this is important.
Yeah. And I think intention anyway always comes through. There is, you know, there is no hiding intention. If people do it for superficial intentions, it will come through. And the authenticity of caring for the people you work with is also pretty evident when you are at the receiving end of it.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Okay. Okay, I think we can move to the part where we answer a few questions. We do have questions here. So we have the first question from Aditi, who's the co-founder of Sathel. Many organizations ask people to take time off or shut down for a while to get through the crisis, but we feel that it's useful for people to have the security of work. Tangible tasks at the workplace can serve as an anchor. But like you said, people react differently. So what should an employer do to take care of everyone's needs?
You're very right. The tangibility or the regularity or the routineness of work is a great support system right now. When nothing seems for sure, having a routine is very, you know, comforting. And, you know, work is something which is going to happen every day. So it's a good resource in that sense. I think, of course, the need is to find balance. The need is to say, okay, some tasks or some regularities are non-negotiable. And then being flexible about things which are not as crucial. And let people choose how much they want to commit to the non-crucial things. Maybe I'm being very, you know, idealistic here, but this is more of a suggestion for organizations to say, okay, hypothetically, this number of days or this number of hours is somewhere you commit so that, you know, an external dependability or external commitment always motivates people more. So, you know, okay, certain number of hours you have to commit in a day, and then say, okay, beyond this, it's your choice. This is the work which needs to be done. You can pick it up tomorrow or you can continue doing it today if this is the comfort you need. So that's one thing. And whenever you're trying to support someone, you know, there is no better way than to ask. Every time we have someone come to therapy, and of course a 200, 500,000 people or even a 50 people big organization can't ask every single person. But just doing check-ins, that what are the employees looking for, to come up with, you know, some process or some policy is a good way to, you know, be more grounded about it. I may assume or read 10 strategies and say this is what is going to work, but nothing works better than in the session saying, what are you looking for, what do you think is needed? And 50 people will give, maybe 30 people will agree on something, or 40 people will agree on something, and the 10 people you sort of ad hoc, you know, adapt to. So it's that. I think asking, keeping something non-negotiable, other things flexible, and letting people choose. And of course, constantly evolving. The situation is constantly evolving. We don't know whether a solution that you have put in place will for sure work out. So being open to things not being, you know, it is not a line drawn in sand, and it can't be a line drawn on stone. We say everything is a line drawn in clay, which unless you don't change it, it doesn't change on its own, but you always can change it. So I think that is an approach that organizations can take.
Nice. And actually, your response sparked another thought, that when organizations are large, like you said, it may be difficult to get to the to all your employees. So the need for training people down the, you know, down the ranks also becomes extremely important, right? So have you guys seen that and undertaken those kinds of efforts? Have larger companies come for these kinds of trainings? You guys also do it or recommend it?
Yeah, I think we see it at both levels, actually, both in terms of manager training and sensitization, HR training and sensitization, because officially those are the designated bodies which oversee a lot of people. But there are also a lot of volunteers who kind of want to support mental health across the organization. So in terms of, you know, some level of first level conversation, how does one escalate, etc. So that's, and in fact, I think this need is increasingly coming from organizations themselves in terms of saying that this is something we'd certainly like to run through the organization. And I think that's a very reassuring sign, because it shows that we are moving from a transactional, let me plug in a solution kind of approach, to say that how do I actually make this run through and through the organization?
So like a first responders team for mental health, something of that.
So we're very of calling it first aid mental health, because it comes with a lot of responsibility. But for people who do want to support people, you know, what are signs to watch out for? How does one escalate, etc.? I think those are things we are trying to support people in more and more.
Okay. Moving to the second question. This is from Ujwal. Who's a development consultant. A critical issue here is that the hand-holding has to come right from the top. If by team we mean smaller functional groups, the team leader, him or herself, may be going through difficult times. How does she or he motivate the team in such cases? All team members should have a role to play, don't you think?
Absolutely right, Ujjal. You know, like I said in the beginning, managers or team leaders or leaders of you know, high senior leadership, they continue to be humans, right? Just because they're in a responsibility role does not mean their own personal lives have come to a standstill, or that somehow they're supposed to not respond to them because this is their primary, you know. It's never going to be like that. And with the kind of numbers we are seeing of people being impacted, a team lead is as likely to be impacted by something as a team member, right? So absolutely, you know, it becomes a team-wise role. In fact, you know, recently we had a conversation on if someone has lost a loved one, the team leader sort of reaches out to them and how quickly they should reach out to them. And somewhere through the conversation, what we also, you know, spoke about is that it doesn't always have to be the team leader. It could be, you know, the person who used to sit next to that person who reaches out, because that's, you know, it's a it's an emotionally intense experience. And if you're not, you know, an emotionally intense response coming from someone who you are not that close to will also seem a little forced. So looking, you know, there's no one single answer. This conversation will always need to be done by a team leader. There is no rule such as that. But just because information has a usual flow, like from senior leadership to middle management to, you know, team leaders, that information will flow. But the ultimate goal is that each individual, each employee is empowered enough to recognize maybe some signs in themselves, recognize signs in people around them, initiate conversations, you know, with people around them, and take that call. The only difference between a manager and an employee or a team lead or a senior leadership is decision-making authority. No one person is more human than the other person. People will have more or less the same kind of skills, right? So everybody, whether I'm the signs that I will tell a manager to pick out on or to be observant of are the same signs that a employee or a colleague can be observant of. So definitely all members need to play a role. Just team lead can be the person who sort of drives, say, awareness efforts and not necessarily support efforts always. That's what I would want to say about it.
Thanks. I think these are the questions that we had. If there are any further questions, we can wait here for a couple more minutes. Great. I think it was a great session, guys. It's the first time for me to be doing a session on mental health. I hope I asked the right questions and right in the sense that they help people understand more about what this is about and how they can go about helping the folks at their circles of influence, really, not just workplaces, even at home and other circles that they have. I'm sure all of us here, when we listen to it, we have our own experiences that we can, you know, sort of remember, and that resonates in so many ways. For example, the thing that you said about people being different, I've seen that so often, about how differently individuals are responding. There are individuals who've gotten into the whole, the mode of helping as many people as they can. There are individuals who had to take a back seat and move away from some of the conversation that's happening around COVID. And both are equally valid, and we have to respect people's ways of coping at this point in time, more importantly than anything else that really resonates. I think we are done then. Okay, we have another question.
That's a question.
Yeah. Is there merit in trying to help someone who needs it but is resisting?
In a more real sense, yes, there is. Even when you're offering help to someone, they might not be open to it for whatever reason at that moment. But the fact that you have offered help will always be taken as a message that this person is available. So if not now, if later, that they need help. Secondly, it might also make them more comfortable. So an initial resistance might also result in a turnaround later. You can also have a conversation of why you are resisting. Maybe like Tanya said earlier, it might be a logistic issue, right, that they're not feeling comfortable. Or maybe it's an awareness issue. They may feel that there is nothing that can be done about it. So it's also, the conversation still is an avenue. And a lot of times what we say is you can't help in any manner, right? You cannot solve people's problems. And neither should everybody carry the burden of solving people's problems. You can always offer practical help. Like we say, okay, somebody is in your family going through a tough time and you can't resolve their problem. You can't resolve a financial crisis or a relationship crisis. You can take care of their responsibilities. You can say, okay, don't worry about food, I'll do it. Or maybe I'll take care of your kids for some time, or, you know, I'll grocery shop for you while I'm doing it for myself. So you can always offer practical help. if you know other help is not being accepted. So I think that's something that you can try.
Yeah. And just to add to that, actually my personal experience, I think this a lot of the crisis that's come today in a way has come after a year of being isolated. So there are instances where people, it's kind of made people even more, solitary in some ways. So perhaps it's a very, interesting sort of, trajectory where you have been isolated for some time and your social circles have been kind of, restricted or constrained. And then suddenly there is a huge need for support, emotional support, and that transition from being sort of, isolated to going out and being open to seek that support can also be a difficult one to make very, very suddenly. And that I think it always helps when people offer their support, even if you may not respond to it immediately, but it seeps in, it does seep in, and it, once you've processed it, you may be more open to going and accepting that help.
So I think just one thing I'd like to add is just also making information available on accessing support and help. I think that's also quite essential. I have a lot of people reach out to me much later or via many different connects in between to say that I've heard you work in this space and I'm kind of not sure where to start. So both in terms of offering help oneself and just saying that these are some resources and things that I've seen or I know of and you might just want to take a look. That also, I think, maybe gives a little bit of empowerment to the person at the other end, as in they feel that, okay, I can maybe explore this on my own and see. So I think that's just one point I'd like to add there.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, because it's not easy for everyone to immediately
to acknowledge.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you so much, guys. Thanks for taking the time out to come and speak with us. And I'm sure everything that you said will be extremely useful to a lot of people who at this point are perhaps struggling or trying to find their way around these situations which are unprecedented. Thank you so much. It was great for me, very enriching, and I hope you guys had a I wouldn't say a good time, but had a good time.
I think we're just happy to be able to talk.
Yeah.
How we can all support each other in this time. So thank you for giving us this opportunity.
Thank you so much, and thanks guys for coming for the talk. Hope you guys find what you're looking for from this session, and otherwise thank you so much. We'll take your
leave. Take care, everyone.
Thank you,
everyone. Bye-bye.